Welcome to Access to Experts podcast, where business success secrets are revealed from world-class experts. And now your host, Debbie Allen.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Access to Experts. I'm your host, Debbie Allen, and I'm looking forward to this conversation today because, you know, I invite guests that are true experts in what they do, but somebody I want to learn from as well. And this person's going to show you how to make more money and have a better life because of it, just based on his own experiences. So let me give a formal introduction to my guest today. After two divorces, I'm up on you with that one, Rennie. Same. Okay. And business failure. Okay. Been there too. But our guest today, Rennie Gabriel, went from broke at age 50 to a multimillionaire after learning the three secrets of wealth. And that was despite actually not passing high school math. So we also have that in common because we weren't very good students, but we learned later in life, thank goodness. And here's the cool thing is that Rennie now donates 100% of his profits from his online programs to a charity that trains rescue dogs for wounded warriors. Love that. And his award-winning best-selling book that you're going to want to grab for sure is called Wealth on Any Income. It's been translated into 8 languages. And today we're going to speak English and we're going to share with you what Rennie is all. Hey, welcome to the show today, Rennie.
Thank you, Debbie. Yeah. If we don't do it in English, I'll have a problem because the only other language I can speak is dog.
Dog, I love that too. Yes, I'm pretty good at that one too. I remember when my first book came out with in one of the different languages, it was in China or something, and I'm looking at it like I can't read anything, but it's pretty cool to say it's in another language. So based on your experience, I love to hear what the shift was like. You know, how did you go from, you know, broke, because that plays, you know, on your mindset. I hate that word broke. It's just like, how'd you go from losing your money? We knew that a lot of it went from the divorce. But to get your head straight again to building $1 million and multi-million dollars, you know, what was kind of the shift to building that and also doing it so well that you became an expert at it?
I would say there are several things that occurred. One of them is abject fear. And that is that I'm 50 years of age. I'm thinking, you know, society is programmed to think when you get to 65, you stop working and you sit around with a torn t-shirt and a can of beer, watch daytime TV, whatever. I said, oh my gosh, in 15 years, either I'm going to be eating tuna or I'm going to be eating cat food. Mm. I've got to get my act together. Now, fortunately, I'd read a lot about what wealthy people have done and do. And one of the most influential books is called The Richest Man in Babylon by George Clason. I had read that for the third time probably prior to my last divorce, which would have been about 1997 or 8. And I said, okay, I got to put it together. So I started saving 10% of what I was earning, and it was only $5,000 a month. So I'm setting aside $500 a month. And in 3 years, I saved a whopping $18,000. Well, one of the other things I say over and over again is wealth creation is a team sport, not a solo sport. I was married for the third and final and last time. My wife and had a real estate person who together they own a couple of rental houses. And I said, well, instead of having a rental house, we should buy multi-units because I took a class at UCLA on how to do that. The difficulty was I only had $18,000, so there wasn't much I could do in Los Angeles.
Right, in real estate, no.
Yeah, but the realtor found a triplex, and he said, Rennie, you should buy this. So he said, I've got $18,000. So my wife chipped in $18,000, and the realtor said, this is a good deal. I'll chip in $36,000. That was our down payment, the three of us. Mm. That three-unit property really launched us because in a few years, it was worth $500,000 more than when we purchased it. We cleaned it up. We re-rented it. We did all that kind of stuff. I borrowed money to make down payments on more apartment buildings with my wife and the realtor. And literally within 5 years, we went from that 3-unit purchase to 50 units we owned and managed.
Love that. Well, real estate is definitely one of the most amazing. I've been involved in real estate for many, many years, fixing and flipping. And then my husband was reinventing himself as an entrepreneur. And then I said, well, hey, you should be, let's do the fix and flip together. And we did kind of a similar thing, started out with, you know, another partnership with that. And now he's building houses and we have some that we built, we rent. So it can go really quickly, you know, if you're willing to do some leverage and look for some creative opportunities. And again, the real estate market in Los Angeles went nuts. And we know over the last few years, it's like anybody that has real estate is looking at like, wow, I never knew that I could build that. So, that's a great way. So, and even listening to that saying, you know, don't think you can do it. You found a partner, the real estate agent, you don't have to do it all by yourself, and having those collaborative connections to start. And it can be small and it can grow very, very quickly.
Yes. And I worked 7 days a week for the first 5-6 years to make it happen. Mm-hmm. But hey, it set me up for the rest of my life.
Exactly. Right. Yes. And so get it. Wealth on any income. I love that, because that title alone makes people that are thinking, well, I've just got a job making $50,000 a year. How am I ever going to be wealthy? And where can I ever get a chance at that? I know that you think the first thing is going through mindset. So that's one thing, but yep. Also being not taking risks. I mean, there's a lot of things, but tell us some of the biggest mistakes you see that entrepreneurs or people that want to build wealth, they're continually making.
I say the biggest mistake is thinking that they have to do it alone. And I don't care if I'm looking at growing a business or creating wealth, it doesn't make any difference. And I'll address it this way. If you look at some of the most successful businesses that people are aware of, like Apple Computer, you have Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs. Everyone knows about Steve Jobs. Let's talk about Berkshire Hathaway. We're talking about Warren Buffett, who's one of the wealthiest men in the world. Now, Debbie, you may have the answer to this, but maybe many of your listeners don't. Do you know who Charlie Munger is?
No.
Oh, Charlie Munger happens to be half of Berkshire Hathaway. It's the two of them. Now, Warren happens to be a visionary, but Charlie Munger executes on Warren's vision, just as Steve Wozniak did with Steve Jobs' visions.
Right, great.
And I can go partners, company yeah. after company, and you'll see that the most successful, Hewlett-Packard, I just could go on and on. They're not built by one person. So an entrepreneur who thinks he has to build a business all by himself is making a huge mistake. Even if they hire a coach, whether they get a partner or not, that really makes a difference.
Yeah, I know that's very true, because, you know, even as an entrepreneur, you know, building what I've built online, I realize, oh, okay, well, if you have collaborative partners, they're going to promote the same thing, you're going to get new people coming. But yes. I grew up into the speaking world thinking, okay, the next stage I get on, I build my list. The next stage you get on, we build my list. Well, you know, 25 years later and 28 countries later, it's like, that is not a sustainable business model. Now it's all gone online. And so a lot of people that are even doing things online, they think they've got to do it by themselves because they start out with no list, you know? So it's the same whether you're in real estate. It's like your real estate, I think online is your database list. Like how big is your database list and who can you play with, you know, bigger partners.
Yeah.
You don't always start out with the big partners, you know, but then you play a bigger game. You position yourself in a different way as an expert. You're going to attract the higher level people that go, hey, we have this in common. I want to support what you're doing.
Yeah. And even if you haven't built a business to attract that high level partner, whether you're talking about John Assaroff or whatever, if you have a connection to that person and they like what it is you're doing, they could still be willing to be a partner. You don't have to have built something massive already.
Right. And I learned that early on when I wrote my book, Confessions of Shameless Self-Promoters. So I found like, who are all my fabulous shameless self-promoters like Mark Victor Hansen and Joe Vitale and people that I follow that were great marketers, right? That they promote themselves.
Yes.
And so I wrote the book with the idea of interviewing them,
mm-hmm.
and creating those connections. And I had no idea how successful that would be because I was, you know, kind of just starting out into a new launch in that expert world back then. And they just took me under their wing and said, hey, come fly with us. You know, this is cool. We like what you're doing. So whether it's just an idea that you're being innovative and you start with a book, or start with an interview series or a podcast series, whatever, you still make those connections. And I believe it's easier than ever before to make these high level connections because of more of the online business we're doing today.
You're absolutely right. And if people think about Napoleon Hill, who was like a newspaper reporter or something like that. And then I think it was Andrew Carnegie said, I want you to go interview these people and I'm not going to pay you. He interviewed the wealthiest people and created the book Think and Grow Rich, right. Which is a foundational piece for anybody.
Yeah, no one person has one original idea. You know, many heads together are always going to be better, right? So give us some more secrets that are in your book so we can, you know, I want my listeners to go grab that book of yours. And so give us some more secrets that the wealthy know that most everybody else doesn't know.
Simple things. You mentioned mindset and I would say there are the three secrets. And one of them happens to be what I call the attitudes. And I have an acronym for the three secrets. It's AFI, which is not the American Film Institute. The A is for attitude. As an example, I just talked about team being the most important thing and not trying to do it by oneself. Another one is that wealthy people, when they hear familiar information, like I've spoken about the book Think and Grow Rich, I spoke about the book The Wealthiest Man in Babylon, people may say, oh, I've heard of that. I know that. That's not new to me. Wealthy people don't make statements when they hear familiar information. Wealthy people ask questions like, how would that apply to me? Mm-hmm. Or who could support me with that? Or when will I do that? Or where will I put the money? Or they ask questions when they hear familiar information. That's a vital attitude. So I also have a book called Attitudes of the Wealthy that covers 30 of the attitudes that wealthy people operate by. They're not afraid to talk about money. They operate from a prosperity attitude instead of a scarcity attitude, you know, on and on and on like that. So attitude is the number one issue. Number two is forms. Most people are familiar with filling out an income and expense form for the bank to say, would you qualify for this loan? What do you own? What do you owe? Except a wealthy person looks at those forms differently. They don't look as an example as their house as an asset that's going to help them retire because they're living in it. It's a personal use asset. It sucks up money and expenses. It doesn't generate an income unless you're using it for Airbnb. But the point is, they look at the forms on what they own as what will produce an income for me. And the last item, investments, most people think, oh, all that's available is the stock market or bonds or mutual funds. No, wealthy people are not limited to those investments. They have oil and gas investments. They have real estate. And there's like 30 different categories in real estate alone. They invest in their own business or they invest in the business of other people, not just through the stock market. So those are the kinds of things that I call the three secrets, the attitude, the forms, and the investments. And wealthy people think differently.
Yeah. And I've always felt as an entrepreneur that, you know, it's like you either build to sell or build to magnify, or sometimes both. And I've always had that model in the back of my head when I was building my retail stores. It's like, okay, I'm not keeping these forever. I'm building them to sell. I'll build it up to the highest level, I think it was, that I can do in this area. And then I'll go on to the next one, next one, next one. And so, yeah, it's a different way of looking at things versus like, you're going to work for a company because you think that's secure and get a paycheck. But we, as we know, nothing is secure unless you have your own, it's your own choice, right? You could be laid off in a second. Anything can happen. A company can go out of business. And then you could feel like, I mean, people that have that mentality of not having an entrepreneur mentality is like, oh, I can't believe I worked for this company for 30 years and now I'm being laid off because their company's going out of business or whatever. Well, what did you create on the side? You can't count on one income stream. And we've both learned that probably through the times that we had our dips in our career is that, counted on being a one-trick pony. I know that, you know, really hurt me, and then I have to reinvent and get back up. And you know, I think that another thing with people that have money, like you mentioned too, is like they think differently. Okay, well, that didn't work. How can I shift that? How can I align myself with somebody else? Or that partnership didn't work because I thought that was the right thing to help me grow my business, but I found out they have different core values and they don't have the same work ethic I do. They don't pay their bills and I pay my bills. You know, I mean, I've left partnerships for all kinds of different reasons. You know, they've ran their course. And even when you think you're going into the perfect, you know, perfect one, you have to be able to say, hey, they work for whatever it is. And we met with from a group that is joint venture partners or collaborative partners. We do smaller things together, like maybe being on a podcast, promote each other because we like each other's work. It doesn't have to, you don't have to look at a partnership as a long-term partnership, but Rennie, what you said about trying to do it on your own, it's like you can't. And there's no reason to.
You can, but it's not effective.
Right. It's painful. Right. Exactly. It could be very thing. So let's talk about now some things that keep people broke. I don't like that word, but we're going to use that word because some people say it probably by that's probably number one, but you got some more things. It's calling yourself broke is probably one of those things.
Well, no, not really. Cause there's a difference between calling yourself broke and saying that you're poor. Because poor is kind of an attitude and nothing's going to shift. But if I have no money, I'm broke. Doesn't mean I'm poor because I have the right mindset. But, you know, so, hey, I've been broke before, but then again, I recreate it because I'm not poor. And so I'd say that's the difference. But the other thing is, what are the things that keep people broke? And one of them has, and a lot of it has to do with the cultural influences we have, like the idea that you've got to pay off debt, credit cards, before you begin to take care of yourself. Like before you start to save or invest, you got to pay the creditors first. That is the absolute worst advice I've ever heard. And the problem is I hear it from some, what I call financial gurus. I hear it from CPAs who say, wait a second, you've got a credit card at 18% interest. You should pay that off first before you go and invest because you're only going to make 6, 8, 10%. Yeah, but the attitude is, oh, I've got to stay a slave to the creditors before I take care of myself. That's the wrong attitude. The book, The Richest Man in Babylon, explains how you have to pay yourself first before you pay the creditors, before you pay your mortgage or rent payment, before you make the auto payment, before you buy the groceries. You must treat yourself like you matter.
That's huge.
And without doing that, nothing's going to shift.
No, because then you're going to always feel like, oh, I can't afford that. You know, and you're saying that, you know, it's like, cause you're made the money, you're working hard. You're just not taking it because you're, like you said, you're paying everybody else off. When we started doing, you know, a lot of the fix and flips type of business is that we would see people losing their homes. And some were just like a lot of these reasons you're talking about, like one lost their home because they were paying off the bills, the hospital bills and the doctor bills because his wife had got cancer. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, you've lost. Now you don't even have a home to stay in. So to take care of her because you felt that you needed to pay off that health debt. And you hear of other ones that are just really just bad choices in how they've, taking care of themselves or, you know, not taking their, the irresponsibility, financial irresponsibility. I know that most people grow up not knowing how to be financially responsible, but
right. I mean, it's not taught in school.
Yeah. And it's rampant. I mean, isn't that crazy? The things they're teaching in school, we don't need to learn. And then why are you not teaching people how to be financially responsible, which is going to sustain everything?
Oh, exactly. I mean, I failed high school math. I just could not get a grip on, I think it was geometry or I don't even remember what the subject was. And I tried my best. I did the homework. I took the tests. I failed every one of them. The teacher was nice to me because he saw how hard I was trying, but I couldn't get it. He gave me a D. But in reality, I did not pass one exam. And you end up with the attitude like, oh, I'm horrible in math. Well, guess what? When I got into college and took some other course, I was tutoring the other kids because it was something I could understand. And then I go into the financial services business, and we're talking about money and money concepts and future and present values and amortization. This stuff made sense to me. Mm-hmm. But it was a different form of math. It had right. nothing to do with the cosine or some formula that meant nothing to me in my real life.
Oh, exactly. You're preaching to the choir here for sure. Like, why can't we just teach it in real life? So where you know, you're going to get out, and you're going to be successful, you know, so much ahead, because it doesn't matter if you're great at memory. And we see this, we have people that think they're brilliant because they have an amazing memory. So they get straight A's and they go to college and they get straight A's and they do great. And they get out there and they have no common sense how to be in the real world. They don't have any financial responsibility. They just are very good at memorizing, but that doesn't mean you're going to be successful in the real world. I always believed, you know, I learned business from the school of hard knocks and good common sense. And I grew up in a really tough business environment, and I'm thankful for that now, you know, learning business in my 20s, you know, doing whatever it takes to turn it around. But I also feel the pain for people that hadn't learned that. And that's what's great that you have put your book out there and your knowledge that you have with your courses, because, you know, there's no reason for people to be stressing out about paying your bills and making things work. I mean, there's all kinds of opportunities out here now, if you're open to listening and learning and, you know, taking one step at a time. You need somebody like Rennie to be your mentor for wealth building and follow the steps. You don't, and that's the thing, you don't have to know the how, you just have to know the people that know how to do it.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, there's a very famous person who said it, you don't need to know how, what you need to know is who.
Oh yeah. Who's going to help me?
Right. Yeah.
Right. Exactly. And your professors are probably the same as mine. Professors were like people that were saying, hey, they're already successful doing that, so let me just work with them and get yep. there sooner and be a good coachable student, because you learn when you're passionate. And, yes. and I was the same way. It was like, you know, when I loved something, I was a sponge to learn. And who doesn't want to learn how to make more money? It's just like a lot of it is just rethinking, you know, and where you're throwing money away and where you're missing out on opportunities, or, you know, keeping yourself stuck. I mean, yeah. you probably see a yeah. lot of that.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, talking about what are the things that are keeping people broke, it's the idea that they need a good credit score to create wealth. When I was starting over at age 50, I didn't have a good credit score. I'd been divorced twice. I had, you know, credit card bills, and all I could do was make the minimum payment. And I had a horrible credit score. But then again, my wife and the realtor had good credit scores, and they were the ones signing on the mortgage. All I came up with was the $18,000. They added me to the loan, but the bank could care less about me. It was using someone else's good credit that helped. Mm-hmm. You don't yeah. have to have it all on your own.
You don't. And that's the biggest lesson you can learn from this podcast today, is you don't have to do it all on your own. Find people. None of the successful people you hear about, you know, look, makes it look easy that they're successful. None of them have done it on their own. They have found ways to make things work and build collaborative partnerships or whatever it is to get there. The only way it won't work for you is if you give up. You give up yeah. first in your head. You don't start looking for it, no matter if you're feeling broke, you're feeling you're listening to this and saying, I just can't get above a certain number. I can't get make any more money than that. Or it's I'm trying to reinvent my business and just nothing's working right now. Is that, you know, you need help. That's what it is. I mean, I believe that when you're going through the biggest pain and stressful times, especially as an entrepreneur, is that it's a wake up call to say you need to shift. And you haven't shifted to a new way of doing things, you know.
And those are your biggest opportunities.
Yeah, it's one of the biggest opportunities, most definitely. And one of the things, Rennie, that makes you really, you know, so special is that you do donate money to the charity that you ask everybody that you interview about that. I know I was on your podcast, and yep. you asked me about my, you know, what I'd like to donate to and what I believe in as a cause too. And I think that's, you know, I think that's another thing, because some people grow up thinking that I don't need so much money. You know, I don't need a lot of money. You know, I don't need to be wealthy, or money's not really good. It's like, yes, it's very good, because you can help other people. It's like you can have a lifestyle of your choice, and that you must help other people. You must be put in a position that if you're gifted this, you're gifted the wealth, that you find a way to give back. And I really admire that about you.
Thank you, Debbie. And talking about that, if people go to my website and listen to my TED talk, they'll understand how, unfortunately, we have been programmed to be poor. And then I offer a cure, which is a 27-page roadmap to complete financial choice. I don't talk about retirement. I don't talk about financial freedom. I talk about having complete financial choice. You choose to work or choose not to work, choose to travel or not. You have the money to choose to do whatever you want to do. And if they go to my website, wealthonanyincome.com/TEDx, they'll hear the TED talk where I talk about how they've been programmed to be poor. And then they can request the cure, which is the 27-page roadmap to complete financial choice.
So wealthonanyincome.com/TEDx to go listen to that and get some great information and then opt in to get your step-by-step process there of, you know, just giving you all of that good stuff. So what a great way to start. And then also grab a copy of Rennie's book, Wealth on Any Income. And what was the other book you mentioned? I like the title.
It's called Attitudes of the Wealthy.
Attitudes of the Wealthy. Yeah. How's that? Awesome. And that when you interviewed different people?
From different sources, yes. There are people I know who had those attitudes. I wrote them down. And Like Tony Robbins says, model what works.
Right.
And so I looked at those attitudes and I just adopted them.
Yes. Wonderful. Well, Rennie, thanks so much for being here with us. Make sure you go to his website. We'll also leave it in the show notes. And if you've enjoyed this session, which I'm sure you have on this podcast, share it out to your network. Let more people know about the wonderful work that Rennie's doing and the difference he's making in people's lives, and especially lives where you have a choice to create the financial freedom that's right for you, to say yes and no to what you want to do. We love that. Thank you again, Rennie, for being here. It's an absolute pleasure to get to know you and your work a lot more today.
Thank you, Debbie. Thank you for the opportunity to promote Shelter to Soldier as the charity and everything else I'm doing.
Thanks for listening to Access to Experts podcast with Debbie Allen, the expert of experts. You can also watch our podcast videos at debbieallen.tv. For more information about your host, visit us at www.debbieallen.com. Remember to subscribe.